It's That's Infotainment with Morgan and John. I'm Morgan.
I'm John.
And today we're talking about Orson Welles' hit, Chimes at Midnight. Hit? Yeah, maybe not a hit. And Gus Van Sant's My Own Private Idaho. All right, how are you, buddy?
Good. Do you remember the movie phone guy?
Yeah, yeah. When you'd call the number to get your
Your announce reminded me of whatever the movie title was. There were times when he would always say it in a very upbeat kind of way, and it always seemed a little strange.
Welcome to Movie Phone.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
For example, like, and this is why it reminded me of it, because you'd call up and to try and find out when My Own Private Idaho was playing, and I'm going to back up from the mic because this is going to get really loud.
Okay.
He goes, "Your selection, My Own Private Idaho, is playing at." And then there was another one, and this is a little inappropriate, but "Your selection, Schindler's List."
I was just thinking, what does he do when it's a movie like that?
Right. I mean, I think maybe that's why they went out of business.
That's so, yeah, because he would yell, "Night and Fog."
Yeah. Happy birthday, buddy.
Hey, thank you. Appreciate that.
How old?
I'm 28.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's really young.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. You know, it's young, you know. Yeah. It's just getting up there.
Yeah, it's, well, no, not even. Not
yeah,
until
I guess
you hit 30.
Yeah.
Like, I have this thing when my friends turn 30, I send them a copy or a MP3 of Jefferson Airplane's song Lather.
Okay.
Lather was 30 years old today. But, I mean, that's not for 2 years. So I
no,
might forget
2 years.
To do it.
I, you know what?
So,
the,
you know,
the one thing, I have been a little bummed about it, I will say. But the one thing is I thought I was 28 all year, pretty much.
Did you really?
Yeah.
So this is a pleasant surprise.
It's kind of nice. It's kind of like daylight savings time, but for my age.
Yeah, I mean, don't be bummed out.
Trust me. Now, before we get into anything, I promised a friend I'd call him on the show, and so he's waiting by the phone now,
so I figure we
should just get to it now, and we'll see if you can tell who it is.
Greetings.
Hi, how's it going?
Hello, how are you?
I'm doing great. Can you tell us who you are?
This is the great Dick Cavett.
I thought it was Peter Lorre. Or George Takei.
No, never Peter Lorre, no.
Isn't Peter Lorre more like this?
Yes, of course, no. Peter Lorre. Of course, his name is... That's the... American pronunciation.
Oh, but, God. I heard that,
the
too.
German pronunciation, the proper pronunciation is
Lore. Lore, right. That's right. That's right.
Now, Dick, we're calling because I heard you had a story.
I have many stories for my... Do you mean the time that Rodale died on my show?
that'd be great.
He just dropped dead. And the thing is, I had a note, a mental note that let's have him back on the show.
What was it like having Groucho on?
Oh, Groucho was fabulous. He, of course, you never got to meet him, but
well, no,
fascinating gentleman.
Yeah, he would come out with the beret and the golf balls on it, and he was a little senile at that point, but still funny.
I was wondering if you could tell us about your dinner that you had.
Oh, of course, I remember. I was telling you this story before. I had the most bizarre evening with Rosemary Clooney, the actress. Singer, you know who I mean. I think she's related to George Clooney in some fact. Right, she's related. So I had this dinner with her at Musso and Frank on Sunset Boulevard. You know the place.
It's on Hollywood.
It's on Hollywood. Yes,
yeah,
of
yeah.
course. Hollywood Boulevard, the Walk of Fame. And so I'm having dinner. It's just they're full of just vim and vigor, and in the middle of this dinner, she just begins to, and no word of this is a lie, begins to start smashing watermelons, just like with a mallet, just beginning to just smash watermelons apart, and there's pieces of watermelon just flying everywhere. It's a mess. And I, you know, oh, I'm sorry, I tell a lie, forgive me. I'm thinking of Gallagher.
Gallagher, right. Are you sure it was Gallagher and not his brother, Gallagher 2?
You know, you may be right about that. Yeah.
I think,
yeah. This was at the Pasadena Ice House.
Right.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much, Dick. Really great talking to you.
Always a pleasure. Please, anytime you want to. I have so many stories.
Dick, you are my favorite name dropper of all time.
Well, thank you very much. I'm happy to drop in many more.
We'll talk to you next time.
All right, talk to you next time, Dick. Thank you very much.
Bye.
That was Adam Bozarth, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, yeah, that was very good.
It's a little Vincent Pricey.
It's a little pricey, but did you hear Dick Cavett on Gilbert Gottfried? Because that was a lot of what he was based on.
For sure.
Peter Lorre thing. And Dick Cavett, he's old. Like he was not following many trains of thoughts.
Oh, really?
On that.
Oh, that's a bummer, because his whole thing was how quick and witty he was. You know?
Right. And in past performance, on past appearances on Gilbert Gottfried, he's been great. But this last time, I don't know, he was a little distracted, but whatever. He's a national treasure.
Sometimes on that show, though, too, you don't realize that they're not in a separate area.
That's true, too.
Because it used to be like a phone call, and now they've got it set up so that it sounds like they're in the same room.
That's right.
And then midway through, you're like, oh, they're on Skype.
Yeah, they're not there.
But kudos to them. It sounds great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, anyway, so that was
better than us.
Dick Cavett. Yeah, better than us.
That was obviously
I'm
on
not
the phone.
Comparing. Yeah. Yeah, and also not the real Dick Cavett.
You could have fooled me.
Yeah, pretty
you
good.
Know, Rosemary Clooney, it was very sad because, I mean, she was, like, considered an excellent jazz singer.
Right.
But I only knew her from, she used to do commercials for tissues in, like, the late 70s.
Oh, wow.
And it was, she would sing, "Extra value is what you get when you buy Coronet." And she'd be like, "I'm Rosemary Clooney." I'm like, "I don't know who Rosemary Clooney is." And then there was another one. This woman was selling salad dressing. And she'd be in the supermarket, and someone would run into her and be like, "Oh my God, Anna Marie Alberghetti." I'm like, "Who the fuck is Anna Marie Alberghetti? Why is this woman so excited?"
That's great.
Yeah, it's really.
That's, you know who should sell tissues is whoever played Camille. Garbo.
Oh, Garbo would have been a good, but by that point she was not being seen too much.
Like, yeah,
sure. You had to get, like, you had to.
You
really
do silent films, then you do talkies, and then you do tissue ads.
Right. Well. Yeah. I mean, and they had to stalk to get pictures of her, like in Central Park. And,
oh, wow.
I mean, any pictures of her, like past the age of 50, are all like candid, like hiding behind bushes. Like, so she would not have been into the whole tissue thing.
That's great. And don't even try to find a picture of her feet. Anyway.
Yeah. I didn't get the feet thing, but you stopped the tape and explained it to me.
I stopped the tape because I thought we were clipping.
For people, I don't know what that means, but...
it's this weird thing on the internet that if you type in anybody's name, like the second result on Google is feet.
But probably, does it work for men too? Probably not.
Probably not. Yeah. I don't think so.
So like Harry Belafonte would not come up.
But no, Sherry you'd have Belafonte to call a friend. Yeah.
Would come up.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Is that really her name? It was Harry and Sherry?
Well, Sherry was his daughter,
okay.
And she was a model, one of the most beautiful women I've ever seen.
Oh, wow.
And she was a regular on the Aaron Spelling series Hotel, where they tried to do Love Boat only in a hotel, but it didn't quite work.
Okay.
And I don't know what she's doing now, but she was beautiful, I'll tell you that much.
Mike Price at The Simpsons tweeted the other day this interesting show that I'd never heard of called, have you heard of this, Bracken's World?
I've heard of it, but I don't know anything about
it. I kind of did a little deep dive on it. It's one of those, sort of, like, it's surprising that it's not Aaron Spelling. Maybe it is. It's like a soap set at a Hollywood movie studio. Or a soap-ish type show. It didn't run for many episodes. But Leslie Nielsen, apparently, plays the head of the studio who you never see.
Perfect.
Like Charlie's Angels.
Like, yeah.
Yeah. But, like, why? Like, why don't you see him? Like, how do you... Because Leslie Nielsen didn't want to give him the days, so he was just like,
send
him tape.
Well, I mean, why didn't you see Charlie?
Well, that's good. I guess, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, I think, yeah, it was...
But if you have Leslie Nielsen...
I'm trying to see if it was a spelling show, because that would make sense, because Charlie's Angels was a spelling show as well, created by Dorothy Kingsley, a woman, unusual for that.
Yeah, but the writing staff had a lot of women as well. And also, what's that man's name? Last name, Pope, who did Cat on a Hot Tin Roof. He wrote episodes of it.
He wrote episodes of Cat on a Hot Tin Roof?
No, he wrote
Wouldn't that be a great series?
That would be a good series. Yeah.
The Adventures of Brick and Skipper.
Yep.
It's a prequel.
You can take it. Give me a movie and I'll tell you what the show would be. But I have to know the movie. Maybe I don't.
Okay.
Maybe I'll do it based on title.
Yeah, right. Okay. Murphy's Romance.
All right. So Murphy's Romance is... It's a Bachelor-like show starring Eddie Murphy as he picks his new wife.
Well, this was a rom-com with Sally Field and James Garner. So
okay.
You're really close.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great. Is it good?
Yeah, it's good. It was Martin Ritt directed it, who directed Sally Field in Norma Rae.
Okay.
To her, you know, Oscar.
Yeah.
And so it was sort of, you know, them getting back together and doing something a little lighter than Norma
Rae. Sure, yeah.
And James Garner, I mean, he's the most likable person to ever be photographed.
Sure.
So, and yeah. She's pretty likable herself, so mm-hmm. It was pretty great.
Yeah.
1982.
I'll have to check that out.
Yeah, check it out. Yeah, you'd like it.
I think the 80s get a bad rap with film.
I hate the 80s.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people that I know and I'm friends with love the 80s. They worship, like, Back to the Future.
Okay.
And, I mean, I think it's just shit. I really
You think Back to the Future is shit?
I hate it.
Oh, wow. I really like it. I wouldn't say that it's... I mean, like, I think that and, like, Ghostbusters and things like that are, like, really great.
Right.
And fun.
And yeah, Ghostbusters is another one that everyone hates me for not caring about. It's not that I don't like it. I just watch it and I'm so unmoved and, like, I'm just not laughing. I don't know.
I think I either saw John Landis or Leonard Maltin at Factor's Deli the other day. Is Leonard Maltin dead?
Leonard Maltin's still alive.
Okay, it
could
have been.
I'll tell you one thing. Yeah. I think Leonard Maltin is older looking than John Landis.
Okay, then it was probably Landis.
Okay.
But I was like, that guy looks like Leonard Maltin. And then I was like, you know what it is?
He would have been thrilled to hear that. Do you know, one of the coldest things ever on a talk show that I've heard, and this, you know, jumps back to Eddie Murphy.
Mm-hmm.
Eddie Murphy was on the Arsenio Hall show.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, this was set up because Eddie Murphy had just been directed by John Landis in Beverly Hills Cop 3.
Okay.
And it was apparently a terrible experience, and it's a terrible movie. And talk about 80s movies, that's like one of the worst. Although I think maybe it came out in the 90s. I
sure.
don't know. But so Arsenio Hall says, so how did it go? Would you work with John Landis again?
Yeah.
And Eddie Murphy said, Vic Morrow will work with John Landis again before I do.
Oh, my God.
Isn't that horrific?
Oh, my God.
I mean, come on.
Jesus.
That's so harsh.
He, like, oh, my God.
And, like, no one in the audience really got it, except a couple people you could hear, like, were, like, gasping.
Was that not, for those of you who don't know, John Landis, when he was directing the Twilight Zone movie, had a big scene with Vic Morrow and two children who were riding on his shoulders through, like, a water scene, and there was a helicopter in the shot.
Right.
A practical, real helicopter. And what I had always heard about it was that Landis said, closer.
Right.
He wanted the helicopter closer in the shot, and essentially it decapitated Vic Morrow and the two kids.
Right.
And there was, like, a murder trial over it that, like, Spielberg was on the stand testifying because he was a producer on the film.
Right.
And, you know, I don't think Landis ever went to jail or
Landis
anything.
Got off.
Yeah.
The jury acquitted him. But, yeah, I mean, it was really tragic. And also...
But was that not national news?
It was huge.
So,
I mean, every night on Entertainment Tonight, when Entertainment Tonight used to do, like, hard news,
yeah,
they would talk about it and talk about the trial and show the footage.
Oh my
which
God.
Was horrific.
I can't believe they'd do that.
I mean, It was like, it was from a video camera kind of far away, so you couldn't really tell, but you definitely saw the helicopter coming down.
Why was somebody filming it on set? It was like an EPK, yeah, like a behind the scenes thing.
Yeah,
thing
I'm
or
not
something.
Sure. Wow. It seemed like, I don't know, for just for the benefit of the effects people, I don't know exactly, but that footage exists and it's online, unfortunately. But yeah, Landis got off and. And I mean, the problem was, and I think it was pretty common at the time, was that they were working way past the time when everyone should have been working.
Sure.
You know, the crew had been, you know, should have been off hours ago, and they were violating child labor laws, having the kids there.
Oh, wow. It's just like a lot of things had to go wrong.
A lot of things went wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was really tragic.
But really brutal.
I'm sorry to bring the room
no,
down.
I mean, it's an interesting part of showbiz history, right. And it's very sad for everybody involved. You know, like, I can't speak to if it was Landis's fault or not. It seems
right.
like a lot of things went wrong.
Well, I think it was just standard practice back then to do what he was doing at the time he was doing it.
Sure.
And all the violations were just done and no one questioned it.
This is in the early 80s or the
late 70s? Yeah, it would have happened in like 1982.
Okay, yeah.
And then the movie came out in 1983.
And Albert Brooks is in it.
Albert Brooks is in the prologue and the epilogue.
Okay. Yeah, he's like a taxi driver, I remember.
Yeah,
that.
Well,
yeah.
He gets killed by Dan Aykroyd, who turns into a...
like a skeleton or something.
A werewolf.
Oh, a werewolf.
You want to see something really scary? Because they're talking about old Twilight Zone episodes. Like, yeah, that was scary. You want to see something really scary?
Nice.
And then they have that segment in the movie with Vic Morrow, and it's clearly cut to... I mean, the story really makes no sense.
Uh-huh.
Like, it's not good. They really should have cut it out and just filmed another segment or something.
That's really interesting.
There have been
a few deaths on camera, you know? Lee from
Brandon
The Crow.
Lee
Brandon
was killed
Lee.
On The Crow.
Because there was a real bullet in the gun, in the prop gun. Isn't that
I think
horrible?
That's not true.
What did you hear?
I think it was a squib.
A squib went out and there was shrapnel.
Right, that's right.
Got it.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
Okay, got it.
But that was still horrible. But I don't think there was any kind of trial with that one. Oh, God, I remember I actually saw a test screening of The Crow.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the Brandon Lee thing had been in the news and I was living in L.A. at that point. I remember filling out the comment card... and filling out, you people are disgusting for releasing this. You should shelve it. You should burn all the footage. You're horrible.
Oh, my God.
I don't
God.
Really feel that way now.
Yeah.
But at the time, you know, I was an angry young man, so.
Jeez. Yeah. I'm sure that ruined their day.
Right. Well, I'm sure it was Weinstein, so.
It was.
I'm sure it didn't ruin his day
well,
at
the
all.
Well, the other thing about that, though, too, is, like, if somebody's killed on your set and you do release the film, their estate still gets, like, money and residuals and
That's
things
right.
from it. So
right.
I don't know if he had any children
right.
or
I don't
family
know
or anything, but it's kind of.
What his next of kin said.
Yeah,
like, it
sure.
was not
yeah.
right of me to write that.
Right.
And if I felt that way, well, actually, we went in blind, not knowing what it was.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy who recruited me to see it was like, trust me, you're going to want to see this.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I was kind of disgusted when I saw what it was, but part of Hollywood history.
Have you seen a lot of test screenings? Like, did you used to go to a lot of those?
Well, I did go to a lot of them, and then for a while I worked for a test screening company.
We've talked about
so,
this,
yeah. I've experienced it quite a lot, yeah.
Have there been any films that were way better in the test screening?
God, the poster child for this is The Disaster Artist.
Oh, sure.
When I saw it in test screening, it was so good.
Really?
It was good.
What
it
changed?
It was funny. It stayed, you know, I saw it, I think, a year and a half. I saw it in test screening a year and a half before it was released.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they just sat on it too long. I think they just sat on it too long. I think they lost sight of it. And,
right.
and the version I saw was really moving and really well done.
Okay.
And I can't tell you exactly what was cut back, but there were definitely things missing that fleshed out the characters of Tommy Wiseau and Greg Sestero.
Uh-huh.
And I'd be really interested to, I don't know, if I ever saw James Franco, I would say, what happened, kind of, what was going on with the studio? Did they force these cuts? Like,
interesting,
like,
yeah.
What's the deal with that?
Right.
Yeah. So that one, and then the other one that was amazing when I saw the test screening, and was still good when it came out, but not as good,
mm-hmm.
was Zodiac.
Oh, sure.
But it was
But I
much,
think that's a good movie.
Right, it's a great movie.
Yeah.
But At the test screening, it was actually much longer.
Yeah.
And it was okay, though.
Right.
You didn't feel the length for a second.
Which is crazy, because it's about 2.5 hours long.
It was over 4 hours.
Holy
over
shit.
Fucking 4 hours.
That's nuts.
And there's one scene where the screen goes blank, and you just hear, like, radio stations changing.
Mm-hmm.
And you hear, like, the songs are going from, like, 1972 to 1973. And that's how they brought you from, like, 72 to 77.
Yeah.
And, like, having some, like, cultural knowledge of that time in history, I thought it was really cool. And, of course, I knew that there's no
that's
way
like
that
the first
was going
to go.
Right,
yeah.
Exactly.
I think I've said it on the show before, but I saw Nine. Do you remember that? Daniel Day-Lewis musical? And it was a similar thing where it was very long. I think it was about like 2.5 hours, the cut that I saw.
It was Rob Marshall, right?
Yeah.
In Chicago, yeah.
That's right. And it was just like there were all these moments in between the songs that were really Fellini-esque and kind of beautiful and meandering
and
long.
And that's
long.
Your thing, though. That's
it
like
totally
love,
is.
Yeah.
And I remember seeing it and being like, you know, this is pretty great because it's a kind of an American homage to 8.5, which is one of the great films of all time. And
I
then,
mean, it's essentially a musical version of 8.5,
yes.
Right? Yeah.
But then, and I was like, don't change a thing. Like,
right.
I said, you know, don't change a thing on the title card. And then, of course, it comes out and it's like cut down to like 1:20 or like 1.5 hours
oh,
or something.
That's so painful.
And it's pretty much just like song, 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 song.
Right.
Without anything in between. You know, which is really like Daniel Day-Lewis acting, which is what we want to see. We don't really, I don't know about you, but I don't really care about him as a singer.
Right. Do you know on Broadway, it was Raul Julia was originally played the Daniel Day-Lewis part.
Oh, I didn't know it was like a play or anything.
Oh, yeah. 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 Mm-hmm. No, it was in 1980. They did it on Broadway, and it was with Raul Julia and Anita Morris. And then they revived it in.
And Raul Julia is from
Adam's
Family.
Family,
right.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Although if he was still alive, he would be annoyed that that's the credit. That
I know. And well, he died pretty young, right?
Because the Spider-Woman, I think, would probably
okay.
be
okay, I've never seen that, yeah.
Check it out. But and then they revived it, I think, in like 2002 with Antonio Banderas.
Okay.
On Broadway.
Nice.
And then on the strength of that revival, they made the movie, which was a terrible flop. But
sure.
Speaking of musicals.
Yeah.
Some sad news in the world of musical comedy.
What?
It was the death of Carol Channing.
Yes. So, John,
yeah,
now that I have you here.
Please.
Who was Carol Channing?
Do you actually not know?
I don't really know.
Okay. Well, it's disturbing to me because I literally heard from, I think, God, I want to say four, but it's actually, I think, five people
okay.
contacting me about the death of Carol Channing, which, I mean, I was never that big of a Carol Channing fan.
Sure.
I don't want to be the Carol Channing guy. But, like, I guess I am.
You just know a lot about that era of show business.
Well, I also used to imitate her a lot.
Okay, well, that would do it, John.
I guess that would. I guess I have only myself to blame.
Yeah.
But Carol Channing was a musical comedy star, and her first big role was, I think, late 40s, early 50s. She was on Broadway in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes.
Okay.
And she introduced the song Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend.
Okay.
Later, you know, made more famous, I think, probably by the
Marilyn Monroe
version when Marilyn Monroe played her role.
Okay.
And that was kind of a very sad recurring theme in her life was that she was Broadway ready, but never film ready, really.
Sure. Yeah.
Because she was just way over the top and crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Just like, I mean, just one of the most insane personalities you've ever come across.
Right.
So in 1964, she, Jerry Herman wrote Hello, Dolly, which was a musical version of The Matchmaker by Thornton Wilder.
Mm-hmm.
And no one wanted to do it. Like, he sent it to Ethel Merman, and she was like, no, I'm retired. And he sent it to Rosalind Russell, and she's like, Ruth Gordon already did this. Ruth Gordon did the non-musical version.
Sure.
So it finally gets down to Carol Channing, and she was kind of like the last choice, sort of an also-ran at that point.
Yeah.
In 1964, and it's a huge, huge smash.
Okay.
In fact, Carol Channing beats Barbara Streisand for the Tony Award
wow.
that year, because mm-hmm. Streisand did Funny Girl, and it was her one Broadway performance.
Sure.
So Streisand has to make do with a special Tony she got to be able to claim EGOT.
Wow.
So I don't think special Tony should really count.
It totally counts.
Does it? How does it count?
Because they're all fucking fake made up bullshits anyway. It's not like an honorary degree. You know, like an honorary degree is not a real degree.
Right.
But a Tony is not a real Tony. There's no such thing.
Well, it is a thing.
Of course it's a thing. People vote on it, yes, but they're bought and paid for. We all know this.
That's true, I guess.
Yeah. I don't know how much the Tonys are. I'm speaking mostly about like things like the Oscars and the Emmys.
Right, right.
Where it's like Argo will win because it's produced by, you know.
I think it's probably less like that with the Tonys, but still like that.
Sure.
So she had this great, like, crazy outsized personality, and I was once, when I was working on Hollywood Square, she was on, and she was getting on in years at this point.
Right.
An older lady.
Uh-huh.
And we did Blondes Have More Fun Week, I think it was.
Good Lord.
And we had, I don't think they would do that now, but
probably not.
We had Barbara Eden on, and Sally Struthers from All in the Family, and Pamela Anderson, and a bunch of other...
And would this have been like Pamela Anderson at the height of like Baywatch?
It was Pamela Anderson 5 years after Baywatch.
Okay, got it. Yeah.
But it was actually a really fun thing because when Henry Winkler and Michael Levin took over the show from whoever was producing it when Whoopi Goldberg was on it, it got so much more fun to work
on. Sure, I bet. Yeah.
Because they embraced like the campy ridiculousness of game shows.
Right.
And did things like Blondes Have More Fun Week.
Uh-huh.
So I'm standing backstage and Carol Channing's there and, you know, I'm watching. I'm a Channing watcher, obviously.
Yeah.
Because five people contacted me and she fucking died.
Right.
So apparently she had worked with Sally Struthers at some point. And remember, she's getting on. And she spots Sally Struthers and Sally Struthers goes, "Oh my God, Carol, how are you?" And Carol Channing goes, "Barbara, it's so nice to see you, Barbara," and gives her a big hug. And Sally Struthers goes, no, Carol, it's Sally." And she goes, "Oh, yeah, Sally." And then I went up to her and...
Who did you think she was? Barbara Streisand?
She thought she was Barbara Eden.
Barbara Eden,
yeah,
okay.
Jeannie, she
thought. Yeah.
And then she was standing backstage not talking to anyone, so I went to make small talk with her. And she had been in the movie version of Thoroughly Modern Millie, which they were doing a stage version on Broadway at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that would be a good, you know, topic of conversation.
Sure.
So I went up to her and I said, Miss Channing, have you seen Thoroughly Modern Millie on Broadway?" And she gets real close up to my face and goes, "No, have you?"
Like all pissed at you for asking. Well, that's why, John, you knew her.
Well, I don't know.
I mean, you've had an interaction with her.
And
not a lot of people.
The most famous story that I tell, that I've been telling for years, was I knew someone who was in a touring... This is maybe not a good story to tell because it's scatological and the woman just died, but whatever.
Let's do it.
So,
We're not above it.
A friend of mine was in the chorus of Hello, Dolly, and they were touring. And they went into this particular theater that did not have, like... specific bathrooms for like stars and like it was sort of like a public bathroom for the whole cast or whatever, or ladies and men, whatever.
Right.
So this girl walks in and apparently Miss Channing is in one of the stalls, and I don't know if Carol Channing was trying make my friend laugh, but suddenly my friend hears Carol Channing say, "Wait a minute, I don't remember eating corn."
What the fuck?
And so that's
Jesus, that's so bad. That's such a bad joke.
We can probably cut that.
No, that's great. That stays on my no way.
But okay, so if I can I think one of the reasons that I was interested in her, or you know, was interested in her voice, I should say, was that Marlo Thomas did a record album for kids in like 1972 called Free to Be You and Me.
After It Girl?
After That Girl.
Okay. Yeah. That Girl.
Yeah. And I have a story about her, but we'll talk about that another day.
Okay.
So she comes out with this album, and it's all about, like, the things we're talking about now, mm-hmm. and treating people equally, and, you know, women, sure. and it's really great. And mm-hmm. my mom, who's a conservative, had no idea about this, so she gets me the album, and I play it to death, which is probably why I'm, like, a fucking communist now. But Carol Channing has this great little segment, and I'd like us to play it.
That'd be great.
It's called Housework.
Okay, let's take a listen.
You know, there are times when we happen to be just sitting there quietly watching TV, when the program we're watching will stop for a while, and suddenly someone appears with a smile and starts to show us how terribly urgent it is to buy some brand of detergent or soap or cleanser or cleaner or powder or paste or wax or bleach to help with the housework. Now, most of the time, it's a lady we see who's doing the housework on TV. She's cheerfully scouring a skillet or two, or she's polishing pots till they gleam like new, or she's scrubbing the tub, or she's mopping the floors, or she's wiping the stains from the walls and the doors, and she's washing the windows, the dishes, the clothes, or waxing the furniture till it just glows, or cleaning the fridge or the stove or the sink with a lighthearted smile and a friendly wink, and she's doing her best to make us think that her soap or detergent or cleanser or cleaner or powder or paste or wax or bleach is the best kind of soap or detergent or cleanser or cleaner or powder or paste or wax or bleach that there is in the whole wide world. And maybe it is, and maybe it isn't. And maybe it does what they say it will do. But I'll tell you one thing I know is true. The lady we see when we're watching TV, the lady who smiles as she scours or scrubs or rubs or washes or wipes or mops or dusts or cleans, or whatever she does on our TV screens, that lady is smiling because she's an actress and she's earning money for learning those speeches that mention those wonderful soaps and detergents and cleansers and cleaners and powders and pastes and waxes and bleaches. So, the very next time you happen to be just sitting there quietly watching TV and you see some nice lady who smiles as she scours or scrubs or rubs or washes or wipes or mops or dusts or cleans, remember, nobody smiles doing housework but those ladies you see on TV. Your mommy hates housework. Your daddy hates housework. I hate housework too. And when you grow up, so will you. Because even if the soap or detergent or cleanser or cleaner or powder or paste or wax or bleach that you use is the very best one, housework is no just fun. No fun. Children, when you have a house of your own, make sure when there's housework to do that you don't have to do it alone. Little boys, little girls, when you're big husbands and wives, if you want all the days of your lives to seem sunny as summer weather, make sure when there's housework to do that you do it together.
That's fantastic.
I think she's great. And
what year was that?
Oh, God, I can get a little emotional listening to that, I have to say. 1971. Yeah.
That's so fantastic.
And I think it explains a lot of why Generation X are the way we are,
yeah,
or
sure.
the way we were, because, mm-hmm. I mean, that's the kind of thing we grew up on, kind of that direct kind of, I'm going to tell you a lesson right now.
Yeah, and well, it's a couple lessons. It's like, A, like, everybody's a sellout and getting paid to say things
right.
are great, and B, it's
that's
not just...
an actress, yeah, and she's being paid. Not just saying jolly.
And also, like, it doesn't have to be just women doing housework.
Exactly.
Yeah,
right. When
right.
you're little boys and little girls. And the whole album is like that. And
yeah,
it's great.
That is
and,
great.
And the other thing I want to play, and this one is much shorter.
Okay.
She actually was really, really good at tearing things apart.
Okay.
Like, she did this parody of one woman shows that were like popular in the late 50s.
Okay.
And I guess like Betty Hutton did one and like Judy Garland did one. And it was always like these kind of self-aggrandizing things.
Yeah, like a little narcissistic.
Right, yeah,
little,
exactly. Yeah, and they yeah. came out with a towel around and their hair down at the end to like do the final
oh
number.
Oh my God.
And
yeah.
she did it brilliantly. So she used to appear on What's My Line.
Okay.
And we did a whole What's My Line episode here, so I'm not going to, like, go through exactly what it was.
Sure.
But during the opening intros, each panelist would introduce the next panelist to come out.
Okay.
And increasingly, over the years, they did these kind of more flowery and long introductions. Sure. And it got very, like, weird and self-important.
Yeah.
And she came out and deflated that so perfectly. Great. Every time she was on, we'll just play the first time. But, I mean, she's taking that... that opening introduction and basically shoving it up their asses, but mm-hmm. they're still laughing. They
sure.
still think it's a joke, but you play it. It's
okay,
funny.
That sounds great.
Tell you the name of a new album, you know who she is. The album is called Carol Channing Entertain. And here's her Carol Channing.
The exciting Broadway star, renowned raconteur, respected authoress, a fashion consultant, devoted mother, helpful wife, steadfast friend, and what's more, a member in good standing of the board of directors of Bonwit Keller's department store. And who right now is in the midst of wrapping all those elegant, expensive Christmas gifts, the busiest body I know, Arlene Franklin.
That's pretty funny.
Yeah, so Carol Channing, a figure of ridicule at times, but actually a very intelligent woman and talented, and she'll be missed. So
yeah.
That's who she is.
That's great. Well, thank you. That I feel like I know now.
Yeah.
Yeah. And she was blonde.
She was blonde her whole life, yeah.
There you go.
As far as I know, from the time she was famous on.
Sure, yeah. Well, that's great. How's everything been going in your life?
Oh, good. And you?
That's fine.
Okay. What are you working on?
A movie. So I've been writing a movie, I think, for a while on this podcast, people have heard.
Oh, yeah.
I'm in the draft, which is great. That's a good place to be, you know. An outline takes longer than a draft for
okay.
me, at least if you're me. I can bang out a draft pretty quickly.
And is there a collaborator on this that you're sending pages to, or are you just doing it on your own?
No, yeah, I owe it. I'm being paid to do it. It's based on a comic book here by Zenoscope. The writers of the original comic have, like, weighed in on the outline and things like that.
Oh, cool.
And, you know, I did a few drafts of an outline, and then I owe them a draft of the script and then a follow-up draft based on their notes. And because I've taken a little while, I'll probably just give them a third draft if they really want one.
Now, when you get notes...
Yeah.
And these are comic book guys, and there might be things they don't understand about... Or
no,
is that not the case?
I've been really lucky with notes from everybody. Like, when I did Survival of the Fittest for Broadway Video, you know, those people have made so many great comedies that they just know what they're doing. And, you know, I was getting notes from Paramount Pictures as well on that.
Right,
and,
right.
You know, those guys aren't dumbasses.
Right.
Especially because of the type of movie it is, which is like a studio comedy.
Uh-huh.
Those notes are very welcome because it's like, well, you guys make studio comedies. I want to make a studio comedy.
Well, that's the kind of attitude I bet they love.
I'm sure.
That's
you know.
So good. Yeah.
Well, it made it better, I do think, because
right.
it made it what I wanted it to be, which is a big studio comedy. And, you know, with the comic, it's they've been very cool about they know that some things need to change to make it a film. You know, the premise has shifted a little bit, but the core is still there. A lot of the characters have changed, but the core of what they originally had written is still there. And that's been a collaboration. Absolutely. And I think kind of we vibe sense of humor wise too, which is good for when I do jokes and things.
Right. Do you hang out with them?
No, not really.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly because I feel guilty about how long it's taken me. I haven't been like, let's go
them.
Get a beer, you know? And then they're like, where
Your
is
eyes
it?
Eyes are cast down.
Yeah, exactly.
Hi guys.
Yeah. 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 No, yeah, I've been very lucky with notes. There's only been a couple times, I'm sure I told that story about when I was working for the Sci-Fi Network and they gave me the worst notes in the world.
Oh yeah, well that makes sense.
Right? About well, I told. Did I tell this story about the Lego Batman?
No.
So we're doing a cold open for Will Arnett's Live from Comic-Con series. I was the head writer, and he was Lego Batman, and we knew we weren't going to have him for a lot of time to do these cold opens for the show. So I pitched, well, he's playing Lego Batman. Why don't we go shoot some things around Comic-Con with a little Batman figure, and then we can get him to do VO in the 15 minutes before the show or whatever, and it'll be the cold open for the second episode. And then he doesn't have to come in. He doesn't have to act, whatever. So we do it, and it's just, it's stupid, but kind of funny. It's like the Batman figure all over Comic-Con, looking at the Hall H, you know. There's a part where he's in front of that big battleship that's there, and he goes, well, it's no bat boat, you know.
He's making wry comments.
Yeah, exactly. And their note was that the boat didn't seem big enough. And I was like, okay, well... It's kind of not, that's, I was like, that's kind of not the joke.
Not a you thing.
Well, I was like, the joke is, it's stuff here in San Diego. And so that's the USS Midway or whatever. That's like a famous tourist attraction in San Diego. So that's why that boat's there. And they were like, right. Well, let's just get another big boat, like down at the harbor, like one of the big yachts that people bring in. So we're like, okay, fine. So we go shoot the figure again in front of a thing. And we're like 2 hours before the show. And so we go shoot the Batman, and they're like, it's not a big enough boat. And it was the biggest yacht there. And I was like, well, the only boat bigger here is this battleship. So we decide to shoot the figure on a green screen now. And now we're about like 45 minutes away from the beginning of the show. So we shoot the figure on a green screen, and we find on Getty Images some footage of the largest boat in the world. There's no bigger boat.
Uh-huh.
And he goes, well, it's no bat boat. And they go, the boat's not big enough. And I go, well, there's no such boat. Like, there's not a bigger boat in the world. And I was like, the
who
old...
do these people think they are? Roy Scheider and Jaws?
I was just, yeah. fair. I was like, so the only boat that's bigger than the largest boat in the world is a battleship. And the guy looks at me and he goes, well, that's a good idea. Why don't we just use a battleship? And I was like, oh, okay. So then we used the original footage that we had in front of the battleship.
I bet you wrung more laughs out of that once the battleship was put in.
Oh, I knew the whole time it was ridiculous.
A lot more chuckles to be had.
Isn't that just
from
nuts?
The size of the boat. Yeah.
So sometimes, like, you get a note because you feel like people just feel like they need to be giving notes to justify their job, and those
right,
are the
and those
I
are the
like.
Worst.
And there's
those
also
have to be the worst things because I mean, it just has nothing to do with creativity.
Yeah, you're like, you're just telling me something so that it's you have an input on something. The other thing that I really hate is anticipated notes. Like when I would work at MTV, I'd get this all the time where it would be like, well, we should cut that because I don't think that, like, Crest Toothpaste is going to like that.
Right.
And you're like, well, you don't work for Crest Toothpaste, so why don't we just send it over and then see if Crest Toothpaste likes it or not?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Crest Toothpaste would have never given a shit. And then instead it's, like, this whole thing. Or, like, recently I did a shoot, and the whole pitch of it was that it was a comedy and kind of nuts and whatever, and I'm hosting it and I'm in it. And apparently, behind the scenes, after I left, this person who works at that company was like, you know, we think it's, like, too funny for the client. Like, so we're going to try to, like, scale back some of the comedy. And it's like, well, why don't – I was like, that's, like, a note that you give at the beginning before you start
right,
shooting.
Because
then you're trying to create a hodgepodge of shit that with material that's just funny and trying to make it not funny somehow and make it straightforward, which it won't be because the deliveries are all jokes.
Yeah.
And plus, it's like, that's not even a note that came from the client. You're assuming the client is going to want that. It's just frustrating.
I had a friend who did promos for Wheel of Fortune and Jeopardy for his living. And it was a really simple job.
They would
take the week of shows, cut together a promo. But there were special weeks where, like, Hershey's would be involved with a special promotion or American Express.
That's when things get crazy.
Those weeks were fucking nightmares because every goddamn American Express executive had an opinion about what my friend was doing.
Yeah.
And it went through like 10 executives who I'm sure are excellent at their jobs but are not, you know, creative.
They're not television people.
And it was just a nightmare for him, and he dreaded those weeks. So,
yeah,
I understand that.
It's things like that where it's just, it's like, why are we...
Yeah.
You know,
what is this?
Yeah, what is this?
Yeah.
What are you gaining from this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, that happens a lot. But then when you start, like, working with bigger people or networks and things like that, I find, like, that those people are actually, like, pretty good at their jobs.
Right.
I've always said it's weird, though, that creative executive is not, like, a major at school. It's not something you can study to do. And the way you get into it more often than not is that you were somebody's assistant.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
And so you were working at a desk, like, you know, managing their calendar. And yes, you read 1,000 scripts a day. You know, you get to know story pretty well. And look, a lot of the worst execs in the world are the ones who are like, look, I'm a writer too. Because then right. then they've got a lot of ideas, you know, and don't necessarily know when to, like, trust people. Like, I think one of the best things I've ever heard about show business is that the entire point is to hire people that you think are better than you, that can do your job better than you, so that you can sit back and then trust them. And to have the, you know, a humbleness or whatever you want to call it to
humility,
thank you, to sit back and know that you've done a good job packaging something.
Sure.
And then let it play right, out. Yeah. Like that,
and then you get so much credit for it being good,
right? Yeah. if you always think that you know better, then you're really bad at hiring people.
Right. Yeah. I was just cataloging an interview by Earl Hagen, who used to write music for the Danny Thomas Show and mm-hmm. Mod Squad, and he mainly worked for the executive Sheldon Leonard,
okay,
who actually is in the Christmas movie with Jimmy Stewart.
It's a Wonderful Life.
It's a Wonderful Life. Yeah. He's the guy at the cashier who says, "Hey, look, I'm giving out angels."
Yeah, yeah. Right.
So he became a television executive.
Oh, okay.
And Earl Hagen was just praising him for, like, knowing when to trust, like, Carl Reiner mm-hmm. Creating the Dick Van Dyke
sure.
Show,
right.
Or, you know, Desi Arnaz creating The Untouchables. Just
right.
People that have been in television, have been successful in television, and
right.
know exactly what they're doing.
Yes.
So, yeah. So that's interesting.
The other, like, interesting showbiz maxim that I've heard is that you, like, the reason it's so hard to get anything made is because you can't really get in trouble for saying no and passing. Like,
right,
if yeah. you pass on something and it turns out to be a big success, it's like, well, who could have known?
Right.
Whereas if you say yes on something that flops, it's your fault.
Right.
It's not like, oh, who could have known that would have flopped? It's like,
say,
you're an
idiot.
I would say
that's not always true, or it didn't always used to be true.
Sure.
Because I think there were probably people at ABC who lost their jobs for turning down The Cosby Show.
Sure.
Which became, like, I don't know if people remember or people were alive at the time, but mm-hmm. it was, like, the biggest show in TV history. Mm-hmm. It was insane.
Well, who is the ABC exec? I want to say his name was Lloyd Braun, but isn't that the name of the guy on Seinfeld?
Yeah, but Lloyd Braun is that based on a real person.
Yeah, but
so,
I don't...
So, yeah, he was an ABC executive. But there's also Bob Iger.
It wasn't Iger. It was the dude who greenlit Lost and Desperate Housewives and all their shows that really brought them back.
Right.
But he got fired because he, you know, gave Lost, like, I think it was, like, a $10 million budget for their pilot or something, and Desperate Housewives, which was really expensive. And then they fired him, and then all those shows
took
off.
It was Lloyd Braun.
It was Lloyd Braun. Yeah, and Lloyd Braun is also the name of the Seinfeld character, right?
That's right.
And so that guy, Matt McCoy, I cast in the Netflix show that I directed, and he was, I am happy to say, the nicest man I've ever worked with.
Was he the first Lloyd Braun or the second Lloyd
Braun? Oh, that's a good question. I don't know.
There was a very attractive, like, not that funny guy who played Lloyd Braun in the first time he appeared, which I think was in the frozen yogurt episode.
Okay.
And then he appears again, like, competing against George to sell computer, or at a computer to sell
I'll show you his photo and you tell me.
And he's more of a funny looking kind of guy.
He's very dry. Yeah. And this guy.
Yeah, that's the second one.
Okay.
That's the better Lloyd Braun.
So,
that's the funnier Lloyd Braun.
So, yeah, kind of like a crapshoot, I just, like, emailed his agents because he was so good on Silicon Valley, and I was like, we're doing this fake opioid ad for Netflix, and I want him to play the, like, the, you know, good-looking white guy in every pharmaceutical ad in the world. And they got back to me, and he wanted to do it, and he showed up, and... You know, we didn't have a huge budget for any of these sketches, and there was, like, no hair and makeup, but we, like, sent him a car and told him, you know, to just show up with, like, a couple outfits if he wouldn't mind, and we'd pay him, like, nothing. And he was just, like, so nice and friendly, and he, you know, showed up, and I was like, thank you so much for doing this. And he's just one of those guys that's, like, I'm the luckiest guy in the world, you know, to get to do what I want to do for a living. Like, that type of person is my favorite showbiz person. And he also did an episode of Lies on Demand, which I wrote for, where he really crushed it. And anyway, I ran into him in Beverly Hills the other day with my friend who's a huge Seinfeld fan.
Oh, my God.
And I was like, oh, we got to go say hey. And, you know, I don't know if he remembered me. I never like to assume that. So I just went like, hey, Matt, good to see you. It's Morgan from the Netflix. Like, you just try to cram how you know each other into your introduction. And he just looked at me and he was like, what do you say, Morgan? Do we make a piece of art or what? And I was like, I think we did. I think it's pretty good. And he was like, well, I'm happy to hear it. Good to see you. Nice meeting your friend. You know, like, have a good day. Just lovely guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. So shout out Matt McCoy.
I once ran into, or didn't run into, but Uncle Leo was at the Museum of Television and Radio at some function we were doing. And I think his catchphrase was like, how are ya? Or something like
sure,
that.
Yeah.
So I went up to him, such an idiot, and I did it. I was like, how are ya? And I think I scared him.
Sure, yeah, that's frightening. Poor man.
Len Lesser.
Nice.
Was Uncle Leo.
Yeah.
He's no longer with us. God rest his soul.
Rest in peace. Yeah. Well, should we get into the movies?
Yeah, Chimes at Midnight.
Great. Now, before we get into it, I must give a little shout out. We are enjoying a nice cup of David Lynch coffee.
And it's really good.
It is really great coffee.
I mean, I'm not a coffee guy.
Yeah,
but this is like uncommonly good. I mean, black. I think it would be a crime to put cream or sugar in this.
I kind of agree.
It's so fucking good.
It's super good. Yeah. I had never had it before. I got it at Whole Foods. It's like $15 a bag, which is a little indulgent, but I like my coffee. It's nice.
That's the ad, right?
I think David that's Lynch the ad. Yeah, it's the ad.
And they don't have to pay us a cent.
Yeah, not even a cent.
You know, I had actually suggested to Morgan that he get some Sherris Sack.
Yes.
Which relates to our movie Chimes at Midnight.
Do you know where I would have even found it?
Yeah, there's at any liquor store you can get dry sack on ice. Or no, it's just called dry sack, but there was a commercial that used to advertise having dry sack on ice.
Yeah.
But I kind of read what it was. And I mean, Wells' character Falstaff praises it to high heaven as being this amazing high. And like, you know, no one should waste no one should waste their time on weak potents or something like that. And he's just praising sack. And, you know, if I had 1,000 sons, I would tell them to drink sack. So I thought we should get it. But then I read what it was. And it's like wine with brandy in it. It sounds really horrible.
Sweet and gross.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure it would be a good, like, feeling.
Yeah,
the way he describes it. I mean, I'm gonna try it.
Well, brandy is a weird drunk, right? Because it's a very warm sort of.
Is it?
It's a warm way to imbibe. Okay. Don't you hate when people say that?
I imbibe.
You remember? Like, I remember when I would go to high school parties and stuff. People would show up and be like, "Hey, man, I brought the libations." And I was like, "Oh God, worst type of dude." It's like white dude with dreadlocks. You want to sack?
Those guys, but
okay,
whatever.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know what? I will say, those dudes all ended up voting for like Ron Paul, though.
They're
that's the problem.
Well, right. Yeah. No. I think there's a subdivision.
Yeah. There's probably where it's like I don't know anything.
I think
about
there's mellow ones that are non-political.
Yeah, but that's the worst thing you could be.
Then there's the nuts that became like followers of QAnon.
Oh God! Let's not even get into that.
Yeah, and I think for me, I'm sort of actually talking around it and avoiding talking about Chimes at Midnight because I don't feel worthy.
How I feel. I think it's probably one of my favorite films of all time. It's definitely like on Letterboxd. It holds the number one spot in my like favorite films, and it has since I saw it a few years back when they did a release at Film Forum in New York.
Right.
And I had never seen it, and I sat down and I watched it, and I was just kind of like shaken, because I had always assumed that like Citizen Kane was his best film, and then he had sort of been given the short end of the stick as he moved forward in his career. Like I love The Trial. I think The Trial's a fantastic movie, and Magnificent Ambersons is very good, but it's probably not officially an Orson Welles film based on what they did to the ending.
Right.
And I saw Chimes and I was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
He's got another great one out there.
Right.
Like, Jesus, we are so lucky.
Yeah, I think the thing that keeps me from wanting to talk about it is that I just don't want to sound stupid. And
yeah.
the thing is that he took, five... Am I okay?
Yeah.
Five different Shakespeare plays and took the relationship between the character of John Falstaff and Prince Hal,
mm-hmm.
who later becomes Henry V.
Right.
And I think it was Henry IV Part 1, Henry IV Part 2, Henry V, and The Merry Wives of Windsor.
And did you know he did that when he was 23 years old?
He did a stage presentation.
He did a stage presentation playing Falstaff at 23.
Right. Incredible.
Insane.
Yeah.
Because he was like a thin, boyish-looking guy.
Right.
Back then. You know? And then a year later, he makes Citizen Kane at 24 years old.
Right. And he later turns into Falstaff.
Basically,
in some ways.
That's the craziest thing to me is how similar the Falstaff character is to Orson Welles.
Right.
I read some review where it was saying that, you know, the Falstaff character was Orson's favorite Shakespearean character for his whole life.
Well, I'm gonna ask you, describe who Falstaff is. Like, what is he?
Well, this is definitely lifted from other critics and stuff been reading.
Right,
but
I
felt like it was a really great example of it. Was he's a guy who his talent is bullshit. He's great at nothing.
He's great at having a good time.
Yes, he's a bullshit artist who is just joyous and wonderful to be around, but he's kind of like a thief. He's a liar. He's kind of a dirtbag. And yet you love him.
And he does what he has to do to get by, but no one holds it against him because it's fucking Falstaff and everyone loves Falstaff.
There's a great line in the thing where he's talking about stealing something from somebody and he says, you know, well, it's no sin to be great at your vocation.
Right.
Which is sort of his ethos throughout the whole thing, right?
I'll describe Prince Hal. He is the heir apparent to the throne of England.
Yep.
His father is Henry IV, who has no use for him.
Yeah.
He hangs around with beggars and thieves, Prince Hal does.
He's slumming it.
He's slumming it, and his head guy, who he looks up to and loves as a father figure in that world, is Falstaff.
Mm-hmm. It's a very modern sort of, like, character. The dude who's, like, a rich guy who's sort of bored. And
is that modern or is that timeless?
It's timeless.
Yeah,
that's what it is.
Yeah. Right,
it's timeless.
And the movie explores their relationship. I'd say the movie is essentially about the end of their relationship because you don't see a lot of them carousing and doing the stuff they used to do.
No, and there's a lot of foreboding and there's a lot of like hints as to what's going to come.
Right, and it's more Prince Hal, later Henry V, having fun at Falstaff's expense with his friend Ned Poins.
Right. And apparently there's not a line in the film that wasn't written by Shakespeare.
Right.
Ebert wrote something very interesting about it, I thought, which is that he was saying
the narration is not by Shakespeare.
Oh, I see.
Read by Ralph Richardson.
Okay. Yeah. But all the dialogue is, I guess.
The dialogue,
And Ebert was saying, and I found this really interesting, that Orson almost, like, improved upon Shakespeare, he thought, because there are these soliloquies in, like, Henry V, which are, you know, obviously spoken alone. And in Falstaff, what he does is he'll have, Falstaff will be listening to Hal as he, you know, does his soliloquy, and you see him in the background, like, getting hurt or hearing it or seeing it, which, like, foreshadows what's to come. And same with Hal. There's a scene where Falstaff's talking about him, and Hal's actually there listening,
right.
Which isn't how it is in the play, but adds this whole other dimension to things that really, like, informs their relationship, which I thought was really, really cool.
Yeah, someone wrote something about Shakespeare in his time or right after Shakespeare died that talked about how a lot of his plays would not, you know, have a great following. People wouldn't show up.
Mm-hmm.
But he said if Ned Poins and Prince Hal and Falstaff were in the play, it would sell out.
Wow.
There was no room to be had. People mm-hmm. loved those characters.
Sure.
And there was one particular actor whose name escapes me who famously played Falstaff. And apparently, here's how stupid I was when I was a kid. Not stupid, but just not knowing.
Yeah.
I'm going to bring up the other movie right now, but we won't discuss it.
We'll try not to.
Yeah, yeah. I'd seen My Own Private Idaho, and I became you know, very interested in it and read a lot about it. And at the time, no one really talked about the fact that it was based so directly on Chimes at Midnight. They just said that it were these Shakespearean characters from Henry V and Henry IV, whatever. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh, well, I'll rent Kenneth Branagh's Henry V. And we'll see, like, I'll get to see, like, what My Own Private Idaho is based on.
Yeah.
But Falstaff is not in Henry V. He's in only the first two.
Right. He dies off.
He dies off camera, but yeah. Branagh actually puts the death scene of Falstaff in the movie.
Okay.
Even though it's not in the play, but I remember renting it and being so disappointed. I'm like, sure. What happened to, like, all the fun My Own Private Idaho thing?
Right.
Not realizing that they had taken place in the earlier Henry IV
sure.
plays.
Yeah, I mean, there's some interesting trivia about it, which is I didn't realize that Anthony Perkins was almost going to play Hal.
Right.
And who ended up playing him? What's his name?
Keith Baxter. Who is beautiful. And I guess Orson Welles had done the play in 1960.
Okay.
He wrote Falstaff or Chimes at Midnight in 1960 and performed it in Ireland, in Dublin, I think.
Sure.
And it was a huge flop.
Right.
And no one was coming, so he had to change it into, like, an evening with Orson Welles, or it was just him telling stories, which, of course, everyone shows up for.
Super
and
sad.
Isn't that so fucking sad?
Yeah.
And then, so, you know, it finishes its run, and Orson Welles tells Keith Baxter, I want to do Chimes at Midnight as a movie, but only if you can play Prince Hal.
Right.
But I guess maybe it didn't happen, and maybe Perkins was considered for a while. Because
no,
they do
apparently,
look exactly
apparently
alike.
Perkins wanted to do it and asked Orson, and he
okay.
said that he'd already promised
right.
the role.
That
to,
makes sense.
To
yeah,
Baxter.
That makes total sense. And Keith Baxter is really great in yeah. that role, and he really didn't do much after that. There's, like, a lot of guest appearances on The Avengers and
okay.
like different
yeah.
like 70s shows, but
yeah.
his career was not that big. Maybe on stage, which I couldn't find any, like, listings of his credits for stage, but as far as, like, movies go, like, his that was kind of his one huge thing.
Not to you know, I said we wouldn't touch on it, but you know, in My Own Private Idaho, it's very similar to the guy who plays Bob. He's not in anything.
Yeah, William Riker.
We'll get into that.
But Keith Baxter does look a lot like Keanu Reeves.
Yeah.
And I remember before I watched Chimes at Midnight, because you couldn't find it anywhere, I thought, well, there's no way he's going to be as attractive as Keanu Reeves. And he is. He's a really
sure.
attractive guy.
Yeah, totally.
And then, how do you pronounce her name? Jean Moreau?
Yeah,
The girl. And then Margaret Rutherford plays the owner of
she's great
like the body house
yeah.
or whatever that is.
There was
she's
an interesting
amazing.
I read that you know, they had to, like, overdub a lot of the film. It was shot on
the
a budget of like
overdubbed,
eight
yeah
except
her thing, except
her
yeah.
thing because he liked her speech so
yeah.
much. And you can hear, like, a generator humming in the background. But yeah, so the whole, like, I guess I feel qualified to talk about the production of it
yeah.
because it, when we start getting into, like, the themes and what it means
right.
how much of a genius Orson Welles is, I can't, like, I feel like my words would
wait,
fail
well,
me.
Well, let's stop there and listen to this clip of Welles talking about Falstaff,
okay.
which he talks about it much more intelligently than I know I could.
Okay, well, so
and
real
I think
quick,
what he says is fascinating.
I was just going to say
ahead.
Before
yeah,
we
yeah,
get
please,
into
I'm
it
sorry.
That he was shot on a budget of like $800,000. It was a Spanish co-production, like, they shot it in Spain
right.
over the course of, like, 2 years with a break between February and or December and February, and like, it was such a ramshackle production. Like, all of his movies were plagued by these sorts of problems. He couldn't get everybody in a room at the same time, so much of the film is shot with doubles. Like, they would do, there was a scene with, like, seven people I read, and each scene is each angle was shot at a completely different time using body doubles. Like, nobody was in the room together.
Wow.
Orson was so embarrassed to perform in front of people that he would only shoot the scenes where he was, like, with people and it needed him to be there. Otherwise, he would use a double, and he saved all of his shots to the end of the film.
Wow.
And to get the movie made, apparently, he had to agree to do Treasure Island.
Right.
Because people thought nobody would see a Shakespeare
well,
film,
I think
which
he
is
told
correct.
People it was Treasure Island he was
well,
doing. Yeah,
well, no, apparently he said, what I'll do is I'll do both. If you allow me to
okay.
do this, I will do Treasure Island for you, and we'll use the same sets, and we'll use the same cast. So he got everybody to agree to also do Treasure Island, and, like, the Hog's Breath Pub, or whatever it's called, is the same set as something from Treasure Island, and all the sets could have been used in Treasure Island. But apparently he never had any intention of actually shooting Treasure Island at all, and in fact he only did like two shots of it, and then just focused all his energy on that. So I just wanted to give a little background because that's like the most Falstaffian way to make a film, which is to just straight up lie and say, yes, of course I'll give you Treasure Island, just let me do this.
Which is
great. All right, so let's take a listen to Orson Welles talking about Falstaff.
Falstaff, I think, is the most unusual figure in fiction in that he is almost entirely a good man. He is a gloriously life-affirming good man, and there are very few gigantic silhouettes on the horizon of fiction who are good. They are always flawed. They are always interesting because of their what is wrong with them. And Falstaff is, somebody once said that Falstaff was Hamlet who stayed in England and got fat, you know, which is amusing to think of, but I don't think it's true, because Hamlet is not a good man, I don't think. And there is hardly a good man in dramatic literature who dominates a whole scene, and Falstaff is, I think, really Merry England. I think Shakespeare was greatly preoccupied, as I am in my humble way, with the loss of innocence. And I think there has always been in England, an older England, which was sweeter and purer, where the hay smelt better and the weather was always springtime, and the daffodils blew in the gentle warm breezes, and it's the
every July peas.
You feel the nostalgia for it in Chaucer, and you feel it all through Shakespeare, and I think that he was profoundly against the modern age, as I am. I'm against my modern age, he was against his. And I think his villains are modern people, just as they're likely to be continental. I always see that the villains in Lear are non-Anglo-Saxon. They're from over there, and they represent the modern world, which includes gouging out eyes and sons being ungrateful to their fathers and all the rest of it. I think he was a typically English writer, archetypically the perfect English writer, in that very thing, that preoccupation with that Camelot, which is the great English legend, you know. And innocence is what Falstaff is. He is a kind of refugee from that world. And he has to live by his wits. He has to be funny. He hasn't a place to sleep if he doesn't get a laugh out of his patron. So it's a rough modern world that he's living in. But I think you have to see in his eyes. That's why I was also very glad to be doing it in black and white, because if it's in color, he must have blue eyes. You know, you've got to see that look that comes out of the age that never existed, but exists in the heart of all English poetry.
Then that rough modern world explodes into one of the most violent, I think, battles.
Terrible battle scene, yes. Which is supposed to show the end of the chivalric idea, you know. It's supposed to show the way it's going to be from now on.
Even the funny tin can running about, which is Falstaff in his armor, but it's funny pathetic. It's not a belly laugh.
It's supposed to be, yeah. The real fact is that that Hotspur, another refugee from Camelot, is dead. And the beady-eyed Tudor is getting ready to be an English hero, you know? And to build that establishment under which Shakespeare must have struggled, because it was a very real establishment. All that was done by terribly good technicians, you know.
And so the cutting.
I was awfully lucky. What?
And the cutting, the editing.
Yeah. Well, I did that. That's what it's made of. It's, you know, if it hadn't been cut, it would have, you can't imagine what a sad, how sad the beginning and end of each shot was, you know. Pitiful in all the wrong senses of the word. Showing a lot of tired gypsy extras turning around wondering whether they were going to eat, you know.
It seems that the Chimes of Midnight gives you particular pleasure to.
In my favorite picture, yeah. If I wanted to get into heaven on the basis of one movie, that's the one I would offer up. I think it's because it is to me the least flawed. Let me put it that way. It is the most successful for what I tried to do. I succeeded more completely, in my view, with that than with anything else.
Ugh, what a speaker.
I could listen to him talk all day.
Yeah.
Really on any subject.
Yeah. But he's especially so fascinating. Stuff about, like, you know, that he loves. That's very
right.
Interesting.
Right. And he's such a good humble bragger.
Yeah.
Talking about how difficult it was to cut together that brilliant battle scene.
Sure.
Which is one of the most amazing things ever put on film.
Yeah, absolutely.
Especially given the budget he had.
Yeah, nothing.
And the
nothing.
Techniques he uses in that were still in the Battle of the Bastards in Game of Thrones like 2 years ago. People are still
sure.
using the techniques that he developed for Chimes at Midnight
yeah.
in the battle scene with limited budget
yeah.
to make it look epic
sure.
and amazing and exciting.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
I mean, he doesn't get enough credit as an editor in general.
Yeah.
Like, you know, especially with Other Side of the Wind. I mean, really what that movie is an exercise in phenomenal editing. I mean, it's really, really on another level good.
Right.
And so, like, it just holds your attention so well. And you can tell there's a lot of similar techniques in this. Like,
I think it's a similar story.
It is. I mean, it definitely is a similar story.
Right.
But, you know, when somebody, you know, comes around a banister and he moves his body and they wipe cut and there's another guy who enters into the scene, it's so frenetic and full of motion throughout that it just holds your attention, even though I think it can sort of, it could have fallen way to being this kind of stale Shakespearean, like a play, right? Like where
right.
you're watching like the Laurence Olivier things where it's
right.
kind of like a wide shot and a bunch of people enter into the frame and start speaking at each other.
Which, I mean, that has its place.
Of course it has its
but
place.
It's
it really
not
lets a performance
movie.
Shine.
It's not a film,
yes,
you know?
Yes, it's like watching Honeymooners or something. It's
right,
like a play.
Right,
like, it's
right.
not it's not like a single camera
that's right.
thing. It's, he made it visceral.
Right.
Yeah.
And, well, speaking of visceral, I mean, I really think that Wells was so lucky to get John Gielgud to play Henry IV.
Mm-hmm.
You can't take your eyes off him every moment he's on screen. And, I mean, that's true in general when he's on screen. And
what are some of his other films?
Well, I mean, he was more known as a stage actor.
Okay.
But he was in a movie called Prospero's Books.
Okay.
He did a very famous comedic turn with Dudley Moore in the movie Arthur.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
For which he won Best
yeah.
Supporting Actor, which
okay.
I guess was probably the most famous role of
sure.
his career.
Right.
And, yeah, it was, like, a lot of Shakespearean roles in the 40s and 50s. I think he's in Julius Caesar with Marlon Brando.
Okay.
But yeah, it was like a lot of Shakespearean stuff with like Maggie Smith and,
okay.
and the actors of that era. And I think he's, I think embarrassingly, he's also in Caligula.
Okay.
I think
I've never
just
seen
like,
that. Yeah.
Oh yeah. That's a big mess. But, but yeah, I did want to play this, this shorter clip, from Chimes at Midnight. Henry IV is dying, and Prince Harry, Henry V, goes to visit him and finds him apparently dead. And he takes the crown and puts it on his head. But it turns out Henry IV is not dead.
No, just sleeping.
Just sleeping. And he runs after him, and they have this following exchange.
Great scene.
Yeah.
But wherefore did you take away the crown? God witness with me when I found no course of breath within your majesty, how cold it struck my heart. Thinking you dead, I spake unto this crown as having sense, and thus upbraided it. The care on thee depending hath fed upon the body of my father. Therefore thou best of gold art worst of gold. Other less fine in carat art more precious, but thou most fine, most honored, most renowned, hast left thy bearer up. Thus, my most royal liege, accusing it, I put it on my head to try with it, as with an enemy that had before my face murdered my father, the quarrel of a true inheritor.
O my son, God put it in thy mind to take it hence, that thou mightst win the more thy father's love, pleading so wisely in excuse of it.
Yeah.
A critic once said that John Gielgud's voice was like a trumpet wrapped in velvet.
Wow.
I think just there's just something about the tone of his voice that's so pleasing, and just his expressions. And he did a short right before he died where he played all of these characters from Shakespeare without any kind of makeup. And in fact, he does like a little bit of Romeo, who I guess is 14 years old. And he's completely wonderful and believable when he's doing Romeo, as he is doing King Lear or Othello or whoever else he does in this Academy Award winning short film that people should seek out. But yeah, so that Wells Got Gielgud was definitely a huge stroke of luck. Because I think, in addition to his amazing editing techniques and his storytelling, to have this world-class Shakespearean actor playing Henry IV was a coup.
Well, and for no money, really.
And for no money,
Just for the chance to work with Orson, I guess, in Spain.
Right. And I think the story of Chimes at Midnight is really unbelievably sad because it's so brilliant, but it got no love from the critics or the audiences when it was released.
It just goes to show that, like, all the greats just don't get it until they're dead.
Right.
Yeah. Have you seen his Othello?
I haven't.
I have to as well.
Well, let's watch that.
Is he in blackface?
I think he probably is, yeah.
Yeah, they used to do that, I guess.
Well, yeah, I think Othellos have been in blackface.
Yeah, up I know until the Laurence very, Olivier one he is.
Up well. Until very recently, I think probably in New York, they were doing it in blackface.
Wow. This is a really brilliant movie. Definitely worth watching, if only for that end scene. Like, you gotta just, if you're not gonna watch it, just go fucking watch
the thing
the
we talked
scene.
About on the last podcast was Wells being, maybe we didn't, but Wells being very interested in the subject of betrayal.
We did talk about it. I mean, it's definitely, you know, the John Huston character and Peter Bogdanovich,
right,
the other side of the wind. I mean, it's the last scene in that film, too, and it plays out almost in the exact same sort of way.
Peter Bogdanovich is his Prince Hal in real life.
It's that, it's like the student not only becomes the master, it's that the student becomes, like, you know, surpasses the master and then rejects the master a little bit.
I mean, I have a question for you. I was reading some analysis of it, and someone says that the look on Wells' face during Prince Hal's, stay 10 miles away from me speech is actually knowing, and that Falstaff knows that this is a destiny that is bound to happen, and the look on his face is saying, let me have it, let's finish this.
Right.
And I, watching it again, I can see that.
I can see that as well. Yeah. I think that, this is the second or third time I've seen the film, and same with My Own Private Idaho, right? Like, Hal is a bad guy, but
he's a sociopath,
yes,
according to what we were told, sure. What we can see.
Yeah, of course. But there's something that is, I don't know. I mean, it's, I don't think he directs him with sympathy. That's all I'm going to say.
Sympathy towards Hal?
Yes. I don't think that you come out of it.
I think that's true.
You come out of it going like, fuck Hal, but you also, it's not like he's this insane villain. It's a thing you can understand, which makes it so much worse. Like, yeah, it makes it so much harder to witness him becoming that way, because he doesn't direct him like this arch, like, nemesis at all.
Yeah.
It's this guy that you learn a lot about, and then it's not a big surprise when it happens. It's this, like you're saying, it's this thing that you know is going to occur, and it makes it all the sadder.
Right, and yeah. Yeah. The other thing I want to address, you know, briefly, is part of what Wells talked about in the clip we heard. And I think it's another thing that I thought was relevant to today, but actually is just relevant to the whole of human history,
sure, yeah.
Is that Shakespeare and Falstaff are looking back on times that were rosy when England was great,
yes,
and everything
it's
was
that
sweet.
Merry,
and that's
merry
what we
England
all
thing.
Do. That's what,
yeah.
we, that's what I do about the 90s. That's yeah. my life. And
sure.
it's really such a waste. I mean, do you see that? Am I crazy? Or?
No, I totally see that. I was reading all... I had not really known about the Merry England thing.
Right.
And there's a whole Wikipedia page about it. And... Yeah,
and Wells says that it's not true. He
right.
says that they're longing for something that never really existed,
yes.
and that's exactly true in my case.
Yeah, absolutely. Everybody just wishes their bones worked, you know? But it's just like, everybody's thinking like, oh, things used to be so much better. Like, my grandma, right? Like, my we love her to death, wonderful woman, but, you know, grew up in the 50s and 60s, you know, that's when she was young, and... misses those times, and when you try to sort of explain that, like, those times weren't great for everybody, and they were full of oppression and racism and, you know, no much better than now.
And they wouldn't be that much greater for her.
Yeah, really. Yeah, yeah. But it's like, you know, it's hard to get that through to somebody because I think they miss being young and having their whole lives ahead of them.
Well, I think you and me both fall into YouTube rabbit holes where we watch old footage from old movies and stuff. And what I do find disheartening is looking at the comments and people saying, this is what real entertainment was.
Sure.
When people were, you know, moral and decent.
Yeah.
And they're talking about, like, the entertainment they grew up with in the 80s.
Yeah.
And I can fucking remember the 80s, and I know that people that grew up in the 40s said the exact
same
thing.
Of course,
thing.
Yeah.
Like, people, it's just, it goes on and on,
yeah.
and it never stops, and no one
it's
stops
like the Beatles, like,
it.
Everybody was like, oh, the Beatles are too loud, like, everybody's parents were like,
right,
you know, turn
no,
that
exactly.
noise off, and now they're like, you know, when we were kids, we had the Beatles.
Right,
you know?
Right, and people would look at movies in the 80s and think, all the women are sluts now, and
yeah.
the people say that exact thing, there's no morals anymore,
yeah,
women,
of course,
it's
yeah.
just like, come on, open up your
and then
mind,
even in
see
the,
what's going on,
even in
dude.
The 50s, it was happening because they were, you know, they like, you know, it's, people didn't like Katharine Hepburn characters. They thought they were too, like,
exactly.
mouthy and noisy.
Can, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, like, yeah. imagine, like, you're 90 years old in 1940 and
right.
you grew up in the 1800s. You'd
right.
be appalled at what was going on.
Absolutely.
It's just like, open
yeah.
your minds,
right.
open your hearts. Come
yeah.
on, people.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, you know, the birth of the bikini. You know, I think what we're saying
God,
is it's
yeah.
hard to be a woman.
Well, I mean, that, you know, that all goes along with
yeah.
it, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, a brilliant film. Absolutely worth seeing.
If you
probably,
haven't seen
probably
it.
One of the best films. I don't know if we will cover a better film on this podcast.
No. And we're lucky because I think for the majority of the time that Chimes at Midnight has existed, there have been sound problems and it was difficult to hear
and find and see
and find it and let alone, you know, even see it, but
yeah.
Criterion took it, cleaned up the sound, amplified it so you can watch it. I did watch it with subtitles just because I'm just not used to watching Shakespeare.
I watched it with subtitles.
I didn't
well.
Want to miss anything.
Yeah.
And that's a great way to watch it, so do yourself a favor, watch this brilliant movie with Orson Welles and Jean Moreau and John Gielgud and Keith Baxter.
And I think,
so
by
good.
The way,
yeah,
I think
yeah.
it really dispels the myth that Orson wasn't, like, a great actor. Like, I think that's something that you hear a little bit, is like, oh, he
yeah.
was a great director, but, you know, not a great actor. And yeah, he's a little broad in some of his things, but, like, good Lord, at the end of this film, the look on his face
right.
is so real and phenomenal. Like, it's really high-class acting.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. All right, moving on.
Let's move on. Let's take a break so I can get some water, and then we'll move on to My Own Private Idaho.
All right, now we're talking
about... You're living in your own private Idaho, living in your own private Idaho. Do you know that song?
No, is that the title of the... Is that why the film is called that?
It's so amazing, the things that people your age don't know. It was a huge hit. Well, maybe not a huge hit, but it was a song by the B-52s.
Mm.
And
I like them.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. They've been doing shows now, and you know they do it without a band. And it's just like three of them on stage singing over, I guess, like a track.
Well, the whole point is their vocals, so I could
I guess that's true. That. Yeah, yeah.
So I guess
the... What's a rock? Lobster.
It is like that.
Yeah.
But I guess the... Either Gus Van Sant didn't want to use the song in the movie, or he couldn't afford to.
Okay.
But one of the first credits at the end is thanks to the B-52s.
Oh, that's hilarious.
He took the title.
Can you, I don't know if you can, but can you establish like when in Gus Van Sant's career this was? Like, had he made films before this?
Yes.
What year is it? Yes, please.
I was in college, and... a suburban kid, and he came out with a brilliant movie called Drugstore Cowboy.
Yeah.
Which I think is still by far his best movie.
Wow.
Like, I don't think he's touched it. Mm-hmm. And it's with Matt Dillon and Kelly Lynch.
Okay.
And, you know, I'm going
Love Matt Dillon.
Yeah, yeah, he's great. I'm going to Emerson and seeking out these kind of movies that are broadening my horizons.
And where's Emerson located?
In Boston.
In Boston.
Back Bay.
Okay.
It's not in the Back Bay anymore. It moved to what used to be the Combat Zone, mm-hmm. but I don't think it's the Combat Zone anymore. I think it's just Emerson now.
Okay.
But yeah, when I was going there, it was in the Back Bay of Boston. I could walk through Kenmore Square and go to... I don't remember the name of the theater, but it was right by BU, mm-hmm. and that's where, like, all of the art house kind of movies played, and where, like, I got a whole education in film history, and, yeah, so I went to see Drugstore Cowboy, and it really captured my imagination, and, I just loved it, and, you know, I was always, and that was his first feature. I think he had done, a short before that,
mm-hmm.
And his second feature, and so Drugstore Cowboy is 1988, and then his second feature is My Own Private Idaho,
okay.
which comes out in 1991.
Yeah.
And was filmed, I guess, throughout 1990, and mm-hmm. there's like hundreds and hundreds of hours of footage, which James Franco took and edited into like this 8-hour opus scored by Michael Stipe, which, get the fuck out of my head, James Franco.
That's pretty funny.
But,
yeah, you are a big REM fan.
Yeah. I do, yeah.
Yeah.
So, call movie phone, find out when it is, and I go, and I'm completely bewildered and confused by it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm still that kid from New Jersey, from suburban New Jersey. I have no understanding of it.
Why did you want to go see it?
Because it was Gus Van Sant. I mean,
yeah,
it was.
You just loved him. Yeah.
And I love Drugstore Cowboy.
Sure.
And I just thought, you know, I had to see the follow-up.
Yeah.
So I go to bed that night, and I dream about it, and I never dream about movies.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, well, there's something to investigate here. I'm going to go back.
Yeah.
And so I went back, and I really loved it. And I went back probably... 8 or 9 more times.
Oh my god!
And it's rare that happens.
Yeah.
And there
I
were a couple
can't think
times
of the last movie.
When it happens, it really like you have a burning desire to see this. You know what it happened with for some reason was Capote.
That's interesting.
I was very driven to see that movie multiple times.
Yeah.
And then you'll make well, I won't say the other one because you'll make fun.
Well,
of
it I got one that's a little embarrassing. I saw The Dark Knight Rises so many times.
Holy shit. Really?
Yeah, I mean, I was 17, and...
That's so ridiculous.
I just thought it... I know, and I, you know me.
No,
like,
that you were 17.
Oh, yeah, 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 I know. Well, like, but you know, like, I was into art films by that time.
Right.
Not even a huge Chris Nolan fan.
Well, listen, to be fair,
yeah.
those Batman movies, I think, are a cut above, like, Marvel fare.
Yeah, well, yeah. And it was at IMAX, and it was,
oh,
like,
God, yeah.
it was this experience.
I could see
it was
that.
70 millimeter.
I understand
it was sort of like my Titanic or something. Like, I had missed that boat.
I get that.
No pun intended.
I get that.
And It was just like, it was like a cinematic experience, and right. the whole Heath Ledger thing, and there was just so much hype around it, and it totally met my expectations the first time, and it was sort of like, this is the movies.
Yeah. Yeah, no, no. I agree. I think it's a great movie, actually. Yeah, so mine that I'm embarrassed to tell you would be probably Pulp Fiction.
Well, I love Pulp Fiction.
I know,
don't
but you make
wrong.
Fun of people that say, "Oh, that's the best movie ever."
Well, that's because they don't know, and it's not. It's that's like frustrating to me. I think
right.
It's frustrating to me when it's like so American.
Yeah.
And it's like Taxi Driver and Pulp Fiction, and it's like you like those movies for all the wrong reasons. It's right. that sort of like macho,
right.
violent thing, and
you're
it's like
an
that's
idiot.
Not.
That's why you love it.
Yeah. Well, it's like that's not. Yeah. Exactly. That you.
Well, if I
can appreciate that movie,
the reason that I saw Pulp Fiction. So many times. I really think it was just Uma Thurman and John Travolta
They're
and the
great.
Dialogue between them.
The dialogue
was
in that movie. Yeah.
So fucking
totally.
Great.
Yeah.
So perfect. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so yeah, I go to see My Own Private Idaho several times, and it moves out of like the art house that's by BU, and it goes into like some small kind of shopping center in the middle of Boston. I follow it there.
Wow. Yeah.
And I took my roommate to see it and a bunch of people, and they're like, "Why is John taking us to see this movie?" I can't really pinpoint still to this day, maybe I'm still on the search of why I dreamt about it that night and why it was so moving. And maybe some of it does have to do with whatever it was Orson Welles loved about Falstaff.
Yeah.
And so that brings us to that Gus Van Sant wrote My Own Private Idaho and based part of it on the story of Prince Hal and Falstaff.
Yeah, like I would say that the first sort of 10 to 15 minutes of the film are sort of its own thing.
Right.
And then when the character of Bob is introduced, it becomes very Shakespearean. It's almost jarring.
Right.
The dialogue almost shifts completely. The way things are cut starts
right.
to...
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it's, it mimics
Chimes
Shots
at are
midnight,
taken from Chimes at Midnight.
Straight out of Chimes at Midnight.
Right.
Even little things like... you know, it's a bunch of like homeless kids living in a building, and even the trash can fire they have there, I noticed is the exact same thing that's in Chimes at Midnight.
Yeah.
There's little homages throughout, and you were saying in the last podcast that not many people had seen Chimes at Midnight, so nobody knew this.
Yeah, nobody knew it. I mean, when Gus Van Sant was asked about it, or when it was written about, it was only that it was taken from Shakespeare. I don't recall anyone talking about Chimes at Midnight at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was impossible to see, which is such a fucking crime.
Sure.
Like that people died never getting to see it is so wrong. Like film buffs, you know?
Right.
So, and I'll say that the movie I think is, consistent in its inconsistency.
Yeah.
Because it becomes like different things, you know, it's the thing that it is at the beginning, almost a documentary style type thing on street life.
Right.
And then
with real kids.
With real kids telling real stories, horrible stories.
Yeah.
And then it becomes like this Shakespearean thing that's taken from Chimes at Midnight. And then it becomes a road movie.
Yeah.
And then it goes back to being, and then it becomes like a weird psychodrama with River Phoenix and his brother, who's also his father. It becomes like Chinatown or something.
Sure, yeah.
And then at the end, at the very end, it goes back to Chimes at Midnight in a scene that is quite heartbreaking
and weirdly
in its own right.
seamlessly. Like it does it very well.
Do you
I
like
think.
It?
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah,
I love it.
It's really
you showed it to me a few years back.
Right.
We watched it together. Loved it then. Upon a rewatch, it's totally worthy of everybody's time. It's a great film.
Yeah.
River Phoenix is phenomenal in it. Keanu Reeves is probably the most
so
beautiful
good.
Man in the world.
Yeah. I mean, him and River Phoenix, my God.
Yeah, it's pretty
and
great.
There's actually, if you watch, there's tons of footage on YouTube. I think some of it from the Franco thing. Of River Phoenix and Keanu Reeves walking around Portland as street boys. And,
okay.
like, the camera is, like, following them, but hidden.
Sure.
And it's like, can you imagine? You're driving down the
just
street.
Cars just crashing
and
into each
Keanu
other.
Reeves is for sale? Now, I'm not into... Never mind.
Yeah, whatever.
But,
yeah. No, yeah, it's a really great film.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so... I'm going to do a little dramatic reading
okay,
here.
Okay, great.
Here's how these lines are in Chimes at Midnight. Can I go? Here's Prince Hal's lines in Chimes at Midnight. What do you have to do with the times of day? unless hours were cups of sack, and minutes cap'ns, and clocks the tongues of bawds, and dials the signs of leaping houses, and the blessed sun itself a fair hot wench in flame-colored taffeta, I see no reason why thou should be so superfluous as to demand the time of day. That same speech in My Own Private Idaho, given by
it's great.
Scott, played by Keanu Reeves, is Bob asked the time, who's the Falstaff character, "What do you care? Why, you wouldn't even look at a clock unless hours were lines of coke, dials looked like the signs of gay bars, or time itself was a fair hustler in leather." And so yeah.
Good. And there's like little things too, like you know, Falstaff's character in Chimes at Midnight, his like little satchel is missing money,
right?
And in My Own Private Idaho, it's cocaine.
Yeah, some sort of
little drug, yeah. Little homages here and there.
I do. Keanu Reeves was in some movie with, I think he reunited with Sandra Bullock or something,
okay.
Or it was some movie about a house.
Yeah,
and there was a trailer, and there was a line in it that I always imitate him. And if I could do that right now,
yes,
you can tell
please.
Me if it's horrible,
please.
As I've been, you know,
yeah.
here's what he said, and it's a very short imitation. He goes, "Marry me, Sarah." What do you think?
Pretty good, John. Pretty good.
He's rolling his eyes.
Okay. Now let me ask you a question. Were you the one who told, this is a quick tangent, were you the one who told me the Keanu Reeves story about him going to party with those kids at the hotel?
Yeah.
Can you tell that story?
Yeah, yeah. So,
I love Keanu Reeves.
Yeah. I had a friend who was at a party at Chateau Marmont, and it gets to be pretty late, like 2 a.m, whatever. And there's a knock on the door, and everyone assumes it is either hotel security or one of the other guests asking them to turn down the music. You open the door, and it's fucking Keanu Reeves. And he goes, "Hey, I smelled the weed, heard the tunes, and figured I'd stop by."
Fucking great. I like to think that if I were famous, I would do things like that.
Yeah, give him a little thrill.
Not even that, but just because it gives you a pass to go have fun, because people feel like they know you. Like all those Bill Murray stories where he shows up to college parties and then does all the dishes and then leaves. It's like, you know,
Andy Kaufman being the busboy at Jerry's.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, that was its own thing.
Yeah.
You know, that's his own, you know, I don't think that was fun for him. I think he was doing that because he needed to.
But, all right, so Keanu Reeves is great in it, and after this, he actually went to Toronto and did Hamlet.
Oh, wow.
Which, I mean, it's hard to find anything online about it.
Sure.
I think they were, like, very careful about keeping out photographers, because there's literally no pictures of it.
Yeah.
But it was around that time that the big rumor came out that Keanu Reeves had married David Geffen in Hawaii.
Oh, wow.
And it was just like,
I didn't know that was a
dude,
rumor.
Dude, everywhere on this one particular weekend in 1995, everyone was talking about how Keanu Reeves married David Geffen in
Hawaii. Why did people think that?
I don't know. At the time, I thought it would be really interesting to try and trace it back and figure out where it came from.
Sure.
And I don't know. I mean, it's never been proven not to be true.
Sure, yeah.
But, yeah. So, Keanu Reeves, and then, you know, of course, you had Speed, and he tried to be an action star, but
I mean, it works now. Like, now he is. He fully is.
Right.
But John Wick and Constantine and stuff.
Right.
Like, he's done, and I think those John Wick movies are pretty great, mostly because of Keanu Reeves' performance. Oh, and The Matrix, obviously.
Yeah, yeah.
He did become an action star.
Well, the sad thing I think about My Own Private Idaho is that they both adapted the lifestyles of the street boys, and they both became addicted to heroin. And Keanu Reeves is not in Bill and Ted 2 that much because he had to go to rehab in the middle of it
because
he was just so messed up.
Sure.
So if you watch it, you can see that he leaves for a huge percentage of the movie.
Wow. Yeah.
We know what happened, to River Phoenix.
Yes, we do.
But, and I think like his performance in the movie is, it's like, it's so raw and, I don't think there's any other performance I can think of where a person left so much exposed, and he's like an open wound in the movie. And he's just, the fact that he wasn't nominated for an Oscar is just so ridiculous because he's so great in it.
Sure.
And he plays this scene by the campfire with, he's a street boy who has only known love when people, or have had sex with people when they've paid for it, and, you know, had been abandoned as a little kid and just had never felt love from anyone.
Sure.
But he feels it from Scott, played by Keanu Reeves,
right,
who's the Prince Hal character, unfortunately. Who, and the River Phoenix character in Chimes at Midnight is Ned Poins, who is not in it that much, but still, like, serves the function of being sort of a rival of,
right, it's
Hal's,
his brother,
attention,
or something, right? Or it's like,
right,
Falstaff calls him his brother.
Right, exactly,
yeah.
Right, right.
Yeah.
But yeah, here, I mean, here's the ultimate scene of the movie, one of the greatest acted scenes ever made. And what it was that Gus Van Sant had not written it to include anything really about Mike and Scott being in love, or Mike being in love with Scott.
Mm-hmm.
And River Phoenix was like, I think there's something here that we're not exploring.
Right.
Which I think is probably also true
it's
of Chimes at Midnight.
Well, I was going to ask.
Yeah.
So to continue, but then we'll talk about
that. I think
yeah,
it's also true of Chimes at Midnight. And River Phoenix went and wrote that speech, and that's by him, that's not by Gus Van Sant.
Wow.
And for a heterosexual guy to be able to express himself,
sure,
in this way,
yeah,
and I think that it's not even about gay or straight, it's
no,
just about, you know, wanting to feel love
and like losing a friend.
Exactly.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, at that point in the film it kind of becomes like a almost like a have you seen, like, La Ventura or anything?
I haven't,
like, two
no,
guys and a girl go to a house, and there's a shift there when she goes missing. But it then kind of meanders into this Italian sort of neorealistic style,
right,
when
yeah,
they get to this farmhouse.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he's looking for his mother, right?
Right.
And doesn't find her there, but
he finds
a lovely young Italian woman.
Right.
who Keanu Reeves falls in love with.
Right.
Yeah.
Much to Mike's chagrin and
yeah,
dismay.
Right.
But yeah, I want to play that campfire scene.
Great. Let's listen to it.
Getting away from everything feels good.
Yeah, it does.
When I left home, the maid asked me where I was off to. I said, wherever, whatever. Have a nice day.
You had a maid?
Yeah.
If I had a normal family and a good upbringing, then I would have been a well-adjusted person.
Depends on what you call normal.
Yeah, it does. Well, you know, normal, like a mom and a dad and a dog and shit like that. Normal. Normal.
So you didn't have a normal dog?
No, I didn't have a dog.
You didn't have a normal dad?
I didn't have a dog or a normal dad anyway. That's all right. I don't feel sorry for myself. I mean, I feel like I'm, you know, well adjusted.
What's a normal dad?
I don't know. I'd like to talk with you. I mean, I'd like to really talk with you. I mean, we're talking right now, but, you know, I don't know. I don't feel like I can be. I don't feel like I can be close to you. I mean, we're close. Right now we're close, but, I mean, you know.
How close? I mean,
I don't know. Whatever.
What?
What do I mean to you?
What do you mean to me? Mike, you're my best friend.
No, man, I know I'm your friend. We're good friends, and it's good to be, you know, good friends. That's a good thing.
So
I just, That's okay. We can be friends. Only have sex with a guy for money. Yeah, I know. And two guys can't love each other. Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, for me, I could love someone even if I, you know, wasn't paid for it. I love you and you don't pay me.
Mike.
I really want to kiss you, man.
That's just like brutally sad.
Yeah, and River Phoenix kills that scene absolutely. And after he died, I actually wrote a letter to LA Weekly about him and that scene, and it got printed.
Oh, did it really?
Yeah.
Do you have it?
I don't, yeah. But it's out there.
You gotta find it. Yeah.
I considered going to like downtown to the library because yeah. I'm sure they have back issues of LA Weekly. It might be a I've actually had people where in the years following, not recently, but in the years following, I would tell people, you know, we'd be talking about River Phoenix, and I would say, I wrote a letter to LA Weekly, and they'd be like, oh my God, that was you?
Oh, wow, like people knew it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And actually, someone was moved by the letter and seeked me out, and he looked just like Ethan Hawke, so it was pretty awesome.
What was it called? Your article, do you remember?
It was a letter. It was just a letter to the editor because they had, you know, printed the news of his death. And,
right.
Man,
I'd love to find that.
Yeah, I'll find it. I'll read it on the next. It'd be really embarrassing.
No, I'm sure it's great. Yeah. But yeah, that scene is so tragic because it's really just like a guy who never experienced love from anybody and then finds it with somebody who like doesn't feel the same way.
Right.
And this movie's. It's so sad just because he's almost rejected twice, right? Like River's character is rejected by Keanu when he meets the woman, and then later when he refuses right. Bob, just like in Chimes at Midnight. And he's, you know, he's talking to Bob in that scene, but River's there. Right.
Well, and I mean, I think actually the character of Scott, the Keanu Reeves character, is worse than Prince Hal. Because the way he is so sympathetic towards Mike, and then to just turn his back on him so suddenly,
right.
I guess there was no way to avoid that because River Phoenix wanted to flesh out this character, and I don't think Van Sant necessarily wanted to make Scott such an asshole,
right?
But I mean, there was kind of no other way to do it,
yeah.
You know, because I mean, for him to turn his back on this kid who he's been helping
right.
for, you know, a couple years apparently, and who opened up to him like that in that scene.
Yeah.
And for him just leave him, oh my God.
Yeah, it's brutal.
Yeah.
It's really brutal.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well.
Well, I used to think that I identified with that character.
Who, Mike?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think... Well, and then I started to think that I identified more with the Falstaff character, but watching it again, I definitely just identify with Mike.
Yeah, that's sure. Yeah, right.
So, yeah, get My Own Private Idaho, watch it. There's a couple of guys that do a podcast called, it's called, like, Masterpiece or Trash or something.
Okay, yeah.
And they did My Own Private Idaho, and they called it Trash, Oh, no, it's masterpiece or museum piece.
Okay.
And they deemed it, like, a bad, not good museum piece. And their analysis of it was kind of very surface and,
yeah,
like, there's, I don't know.
What,
I
just, like, some of the performances are broad when it's Shakespearean?
Well, or
like,
yes, well, exactly.
Yeah, that's not, like, that's...
That,
not,
it's inconsistent, right, and that makes no sense
and
to them.
And that's kind of what makes it
okay.
Great. Right. And, like, yeah, that's funny. Yeah, well, fuck those guys. What the fuck do they know?
So, okay, so, yes, Watch My Own Private Idaho.
Yeah.
It's really great. It's a seminal movie in my life. It is not nearly the great movie that Chimes at Midnight is.
But it's a different film, and it's great in its
film.
Own right.
Yeah,
we can't start comparing right. things to Chimes at Midnight.
Right, right. Because everything
yeah.
suffers
yeah,
in comparison.
Absolutely.
So,
yeah.
it being your birthday, I have a special edition of Celebrity Rant Justified or Unjustified.
I can't wait to hear it.
So,
do you want to set it up?
It's a famous actor doing a voiceover,
mm-hmm.
and he gets annoyed at the person who's trying to direct him.
Great.
Yeah.
I can't wait to hear it.
We know a remote farm.
How have we not done this one?
I don't know.
Every
it's
July,
the original
rant. Please grow there. Do you really mean that?
Do you really mean that?
I'd start half a second late.
Don't you think you really want to say July over the snow? Isn't that the fun of it?
If you can make it almost when that shot disappears, it'll make my...
I think it's so nice that you see a snow-covered field and say every July, please grow there.
It's true.
We know a remote farm in Lincolnshire, where Mrs. Buckley lives. Every July, peas grow there. We aren't even in the fields, you see.
We aren't even in the fields, you see. So
we're
great.
Talking about them growing, and she's picked them.
Yeah.
What? I don't understand you, then. What must be over for July?
When we get out of that snowy field.
When I was out, we were onto a can of peas, a big dish of peas, when I said in July.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes, always.
Yes.
I'm always past that. Yeah. Yes. Well, that's about where I say in July.
Can you emphasize a bit in July?
Why? That doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, does he say, like,
why?
Show me an English sentence.
There's no known begins... way of saying
yeah,
an English
go down
sentence
on.
In which you begin a sentence with in and emphasize it.
In
Get me a
July.
Jury. Show me how you can say in July. Go down on you. That's just idiotic, if you'll forgive me by saying so.
Never directed any living actor
in July.
To do
I'd love to know how you emphasize in and in July. Impossible. Meaningless.
Ludicrous. I think all they were thinking about was that they didn't want to...
He isn't thinking.
Well, so can I just...
Yeah?
It was my fault. I said in July. If you can leave every July.
You didn't say it. He said it.
Your friend.
Your friend.
Yes.
Every
Your
July.
Your friend.
No, you don't really mean every July. But that's bad copy. It's in July. Of course it's every July. It's too much directing around here. Norway. Fish fingers, Findus, Norway.
Crumb Christian.
We know a certain fjord in Norway. Near where the cod gather in great shoals. There, Jan Stangeland.
Jan Stangeland.
More on that shoals thing, because you roll it around very nicely.
Yeah, roll it around and I have no more time.
You
know
what
I'm up against. Because it's full of things that are only correct because they're grammatical, but they're tough on the ear. You see, this is a very wearying one. It's unpleasant to read. Unrewarding.
Unrewarding.
Because Findus frees the cod at sea and then add a crumb crisp coating. Ah, that's tough, crumb crisp coating. I think, no, because of the way it's written, you need to break it up, because it's not as conversationally written. What?
Take crumb out.
Good. Here under protest is beef burger. We know a little place in the American far west where Charlie Briggs chops up the finest prairie-fed beef and tastes... This is a lot of shit, you know that. You want one more?
Yeah.
More on what beef?
You missed the first beef, actually, completely.
What do you mean, missed it?
Such pests.
You're emphasizing prairie fed.
But you can't emphasize beef. That's like he's wanting me to emphasize in before July. Come on, fellas, you're losing your heads. I wouldn't direct any living actor like this in Shakespeare. Will you do this? It's impossible.
Orson, you did six last year, and by far and away the best, and I know the reason.
The right reading for this is the one I'm giving it.
At the moment.
I spent 20 times more for you people than any other commercial I've ever made. You are such pests. Now, what is it you want
no, I think
in
you
your depths of your ignorance? What is it you want? Whatever it is you want, I can't deliver because I just don't see it.
That was absolutely fine. It really was. You
Maybe worth it. No money is worth it.
Yeah, I don't know, man. Justified or unjustified?
What do you think?
What do I think? I think it's Orson Welles, and it's probably justified. He probably knows better than they do. He seems a little maybe drunk.
Well, he's definitely irritated.
Yeah, he's mean.
Well, listening today for the first time in a while, I understand what they're asking for when they tell him to emphasize every July.
Yeah, he's
July.
Just delivering it.
They're asking him to say, you know, the field is covered with snow, but then every July, peas grow there.
Right.
They're asking him to emphasize every July, not in July.
Yeah.
But try explaining that to him once he gets going. There'd be no way.
Right.
So I would say unjustified, but it's Orson Welles, so it's justified.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's very funny to do an analysis of this.
Right.
Just because I've heard it so many times.
Sure.
Have you seen the Pinky and the Brain one? I mean,
you had a whole party around it.
It's so fun. Oh, yeah, I did. I had gotten my hands on some of the Orson Welles talk shows, his AFI special, mm-hmm. some things like that, and I invited a small group of people over to my house to sort of watch all of them.
Yeah.
Definitely very, very fun time.
A fun evening, yeah.
Yeah, fun evening with little things in between. Like,
Was the guest on his talk show Burt Reynolds? Right.
Yeah, it was Burt Reynolds who had just done a made-for-TV movie.
Did they make fun of Peter Bogdanovich?
Not in that one. That right. was on...
Carson.
That was Carson.
Yeah.
There was an interesting... Richard Brody wrote an article about Chimes at Midnight, which I thought was very interesting. And he was just sort of saying that, you know, Orson was so much like Falstaff in the sense that towards the end of his career, it was just such a shame because he couldn't get anything made. And then, you know, they started casting him as an actor. And then it became this thing where he was more sought after for his famousness than anything that he really could bring to things. So it was like... You know, he was a commercial guy, and then they would just have him, like you were saying about his play, where like he had to trash it so that these people just could come see him talk.
Right. Yeah,
and he became
like
a magician, and he, you know, all these things.
Well,
he
became a consummate talk show guest
yeah.
which was great.
Of course, that's
always,
wonderful.
Even with Dinah Shore, he's fascinating.
Sure, yeah, So I think that if you're hiring Orson Welles to do your commercial, you should have respected his fucking genius and just let him do whatever the hell he wanted.
Did you see the thing where Mel Brooks talks about hiring him for History of the World Part 1?
No.
So he hires him for a week for, like, I don't know, 5 hours a day. And Orson Welles, like, gets it all done, like, in one day.
Yeah.
Like, he's such a professional. And,
sure.
And Mel Brooks has no complaints about
right.
it, but he still has to pay him
$25,000. Right.
So he's like, well, Orson, what are you going to do with the $25,000? He goes, Cuban cigars and this fine wine. And he named some wine.
Yeah.
And he said, and I would get women, but I'm getting a bit fat for that.
Well, I think that's a great place to end it.
It's a great place to end on.
Thanks.
This was a fun one.
Yeah,
thank you very much. And happy birthday, Morgan.
Yeah, absolutely. And we'll have another one next month.
Yep.
All right. Bye, guys.
Bye.